That's something, please, that you might like to consider availing yourself of and helping the collection a little bit further in the process before you make your way home at the end of what we hope has been an enjoyable afternoon. By now you've all availed yourselves of a copy of the souvenir program. It is priced at £3. It too. Indo in particular, it will tell you a little about the individual aircraft. You'll also see that there is a section on air racing in the programme, because that is a rare feature in today's programme. A race for the almost trophy, but that is another story. We'll come to that a little later on. If nothing else, it's a classic demonstration of a line that I know the regulars amongst you will know. But I certainly hope you've got a lot of first-time visitors here today as well. And that is the fundamental that safety must come before spectacle. Conservation must come before demonstration. So, regrettably, it means we aren't going to see the Gladiator display this afternoon. But nonetheless, it does help ensure that we've got a Gladiator to display another time. That is the fundamental. Flaps down, as you can see. Flaps on both the upper and lower planes of the Gladiator were a feature that allowed it to be used in the smaller airfields, particularly during the Battle of Britain, and indeed on aircraft carrier deck. As you can see, a very uneventful arrival. Fighter in the RAF, once it gave up its Gladiators, it comes into the Hurricane. The 73 Squadron was part of the Advanced Air Strike Force, along with number 1 Squadron on the Hurricane, together with 85 and 87 Squadron, to form the air component of the British Expeditionary Forces, its part of the Advanced Forces. anticipate the arrival of the Hurricane Mark with the demise of the twin gun biplane, legitimised by the Gladiator, although it did have another two machine guns mounted on the ultra low plane. Hurricane was the RAF's first fighter capable of exceeding 300 miles an hour. .303 inch machine gun in the wings were the key difference in the armament that the Hurricane introduced. So the robustness and the potential of the airframe allowed that to be much developed. The Mark IIb introduced 12.30 inch machine guns in the wing, while the 2C had four 20mm cannons. And those two marks went into service in 1941. While later in that year, the first Harry Bombers went into action. That was in September 1941. Carrying first two 250-pound and then two 500-pound bombs, while still remaining the wing gun. Those aircraft were used on anti-shipping patrols in the Mediterranean and the Channel, and against enemy armour in the Western Desert. By 1942, however, the Hurricane was being outclassed as a fighter in the European theatre, but had shown itself suitable for ground attack. The Hurricane became the first single-seat fighter of the war to carry rockets. 60-pound rockets, 8 feet 3 inches long, while the 2D version had two 40mm because S guns used with good effect against enemy tanks in North Africa and Burma. The final version produced in this country to the building standard of 2 was the Hurricane 4, with the so-called universal wing, capable of being fitted with long-range tanks, two 40mm cannons, eight of those rockets or 500 pounds of bombs in various combinations. Very heavily armor-plated, it was used in the low-level attack role in Tunisia, Burma and Italy, and the Mark IV formed the last Hurricane squadron in the Royal Air Force, number 6 squadron, which served in Palestine until January 1947. Typically a Rolls-Royce Merlin 20 of some 1,280 horsepower. Maximum speed therefore around 339 miles an hour, around 28,000 feet. Roger Bailey, the collection's chief pilot, displays the aircraft, which is in the markings of the fleet air arm of the Royal Navy, representing a Sea Hurricane, as indeed it is, 1B. In fact, the markings are those of Operation Pedestal, the most famous action involving the Sea Hurricane, covering the convoy that sailed for Malta in August 1942. Now, the last of the trio, a very different role, the Westland Lysander. Operation Pedestal in 1942. Well, the markings worn by this aircraft were for, or represent those for Operation Apollo in 1942. And the markings are of 161 Squadron of the Royal Air Force. Known, I think, is that RAF Bomber Command largely went about his work by night. Well, they were not alone. So too, it was by night that the Lysanders and those supporting the Special Operations Executive, remember those who were urged by Churchill, indeed they were so called, their task was to set Europe alight. So the work of Lysanders like this, operating in particular initially from Newmarket and then from Temford, just a little way up the A1 from here, was to insert and bring back some very special passengers, members of the Special Operations Executive and VIPs and those with very special skills and information, inserted into the smallest of wheels in the team. In occupied France in particular. Hence the overload fuel tank beneath the centre fuselage, initially for its Army Com operation role. That was the one for which the aircraft was originally designed and ordered. A long hook would have been carried, working with Army units in the front line. So the task, therefore, was to supply and retrieve information. Supplying it was relatively easy, delivering it over the side of the cockpit. Retrieving it meant flying the aircraft hooked down to snatch a line extended between two posts to grab the message or whatever it might be. To return the intelligence to headquarters. In this case, designed for single crew operation, because that second seat was going to be the one that would take the Joe, the agent, or indeed retrieve, back from France. And that is why you'll see, indeed when the aircraft lands back on, you'll see the ladder fixed down the side of the fuselage to make access and egress from the aircraft as quick as possible. In this day and age of the sat-nav, I ask you to consider the task of getting this aeroplane all the way from Temford into the further front corners of France. on your own by dead reckoning at night, and you have to arrive amidst people who didn't want you to be doing anything of the sort. A 12. Around 800 mighty horsepower, typically in a Mercury 12. The maximum speed around 220 miles an hour. Probably just flip the foot of the ladder on the other side there, but as Keith brings the aircraft round to return to its parking position, you'll be able to see it more quickly. You'll see too, as the aircraft actually dive, that the pilot sits quite high in the fuselage, giving you a good view over the sides of the fuselage. Again, very good for the air observation well. The aircraft is lining up. Landing on, Roger Bailey in the Sea Hurricane. Now, I suggest this as an unusual feature of today's flying program would be an air race. Well, it's a slightly tongue-in-cheek air race, which is perhaps something to do with the fact that I said that this is for the almost trophy. Inevitably, one must talk about the history of air racing. Well, it's quite simple. Somebody built an aircraft. Didn't think of air racing at the time. That didn't happen until someone built a second aircraft. Then on it became a feature of aviation, and it begins now with the third of the field.